Thank you, Jesus. I believe the King of Kings is in this room today. Hallelujah. His presence is here. Our King and our God. We are here to worship Him. And He said, pray that heaven would come to earth. And I believe today, heaven, the angels of our God are here today worshiping with us. They are worshiping with us in the atmosphere that is here. Demonic forces can't remain in a place like this. So let's just give one more shout. Can we do that? Shout to our King. God, your King. You are King. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus, hallelujah. No other name but the name of Jesus, hallelujah. Praise God, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, hallelujah. Let's shout about that, hallelujah. Thank you, God, He's healed. Thank you, Jesus, praise God, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, hallelujah. Yes, amen. And right now we want to pray for the other Tom Slack. He's in Rochester. And so he had a blood clot, they said. And so we're just declaring in Jesus' name that we thank you, God, that the angels, we thank you that your presence is invading that room right now. And we thank you for a good report. Thank you, Father, that he's completely healed in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you for it. Hallelujah. Jesus said that it's time for the outpouring, right? It's time for the healing. It's time for miracles and signs and wonders. Hallelujah. And it's not by our power, but it's by the word of the Lord. So this morning, before anything else happens, we're going to pray. Many leaders in the nation have asked for us to pray for Afghanistan and the Christians there. So they asked us if we would fast and pray, if you guys want to join in fasting some today. But we know it's a serious situation, right? But there's many people, and that God has secret ways. And God is a powerful God. So we are going to pray. Remember in the Old Testament, God blinded the eyes of the enemy, right? And remember when David saw the giant, he said, an uncircumcised Philistine. He didn't say, oh, he's big. So we're going to believe today. We're going to pray and join forces. We're going to unite in prayer, and we're going to believe for God to do mighty things in Afghanistan, because there's many people that have plans to get them out. Of course, they're not telling us the plans, but God's got a plan, right? So we thank you, Jesus. We just declare right now that if in Afghanistan, we release the angels, the armies of heaven. We release the angels and the armies of heaven to go and protect the body of Christ, protect those Afghanistans who have helped the Americans, Lord. I thank you, Jesus. And we declare with Robbie Dawkins, one of the ministers that goes over there, that in 8 years, Afghanistan is going to be a Christian nation. We just declare that. And we thank you, God. We thank you, God, that you are actually coming in dreams, and the fear of God is coming upon the Taliban. I thank you. They are going to bow their knee to Jesus Christ. We release the fear of God upon the Taliban. We release it now in Jesus' name. And we just declare, God, that you're protecting the Christians. You're blinding the eyes of the enemy. And you're giving them dreams of how to escape. And you are providing food for them, Lord. If it's supernaturally, God, you're a supernatural God. And we thank you, God. And we're looking forward to hearing the results and hearing of testimonies of what you have done for the Afghanistan people in Jesus' mighty name. And we agree. Everyone who agrees says, amen. Okay. Well, you're good-looking people, so welcome, and say hi to your neighbors. Well, Steve asked if I would take the offering this morning, and so I brought a couple props here, and all of these. So can you guess what this is from? My grandkids. Anyway, I'm going to brag on them a little bit. I know your grandkids are wonderful, but I was convicted by this. My grandkids seem to never come to my house with empty hands. And you know, God is a giving God. And they're showing me what a giver is. Every time they come, they have made me pictures. They bring me rocks and stones. Sometimes they even give me their money. They go, "Here, Grandma, here's some money." And I just think that God has an abundance. Stephanie, my daughter, was taking pictures of a family in a sunflower field, and I took one of those sunflowers, and there's so many seeds in there. I looked up on the internet how many seeds are in one head. They said 1 to 2,000 seeds. And I thought, you know, God is a multiplier. God is the God of abundance. And so if we learn to give, and this is one way you can give is in tithes and offerings. And we're giving back to what God has given us. But, you know, there's so many other ways to give. I'm going to challenge you to give during the week. Give, you know, think how you can bless somebody. And pretty stones. You can find some pretty stones to give somebody. But I'm just telling you, my kids even bring flowers. And it's flowers they haven't planted, wildflowers. God planted them. There's an abundance. God has an abundance. So find ways to give every place you go. Find ways to give a smile. One of the best things I love is a smile and a hug and a squeal because Grandma's here. And so, I mean, brightening of your face, giving people a smile, giving people a hug. We are giving people, right? We are giving people. And the Bible says in Luke 6:38, give and it shall be given unto you. Pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give into your bosom. So, today, if the ushers would get ready, and if you're giving cash and would like an envelope so you can get a receipt, just raise your hand and they will give you an envelope. Otherwise, make your checks payable to Destiny Church, and then you can also give text to give. So I'm just going to pray over this offering, and we're just going to bless it and believe for return. Okay. Well, we thank you, Jesus, that you are a giving God. God, we thank you that there is abundance in this earth that you made, God. It's overflowing. There's never a shortage, God. We just have to tap in. We just have to tap in to your abundance, God. And so today, I just declare an abundance over the giving today, an abundance over the lives of these people here today. God, bless them abundantly and teach us to be givers, Lord. Teach us to let it flow through our hands, God. So we thank you. We give you thanks today in Jesus' name. Amen. You can pass the buckets, guys.
Well, God's good. It's good to see your smiling faces, and as they pass the buckets, just make you aware of a couple announcements. Picnic is next week, and Gina's going to bring her horses, so that gives you an opportunity to ride a horse. Your long flowing hair as you ride across the sunset, it doesn't really work that way, but does it, Gina? But also, there's a water baptism next Sunday, and so we'll have the tank here, and we'll be water baptizing people. And then after church today, pretty close to, like right away after church, we're going to go golfing, the men are. But first of all, we're going to go to my house to have a quick lunch so you get some strength up, so you can be able to hit that ball really good. So there's about 12 guys signed up. So we'll be going within 15, 20 minutes. And my house, Dave over here, smile, Dave. Here, there's Dave. If you need directions to my house, it's just actually 2 miles straight south. But if you go 1 mile, there's a big slough. So then you have to kind of go around the slough. So, but it's actually just 2 miles straight south. So Dave will give you my address. Do you know my address? Okay, Dave will give you my address. And then we're going to Pine Ridge Golf Course, and our first tee time is 1:45, and it's raining at 4. So we got 2 hours, basically, to get through. And I know that a lot of you are love golf. I know I have some friends that just love golf. They live for golf, but they're not playing today. I don't know why that is. But anyways, well, it's good to have you here. It's good to be here. Been gone a couple of weeks. I listened online to the sermons. I thought, feeling intimidated now after these sermons these kids been preaching. I thought, now I got to come back. I got to really make this good. Otherwise, people are going to go, get the young guys on there. These old guys, the old guys had it. Like Joshua stood up and said, Moses is dead, you know, he's gone. So, but I'm not. I'm still alive and kicking. But anyways, if you have your Bibles, I titled this message, God is Good. And I've been talking to you about foundational subjects. The last 2 weeks that I spoke, I talked about Scripture, the Word of God, how all Scripture is inspired by God, all of it. All Scripture inspired by God. That's what we believe. Because that's what the Bible says about itself. All Scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for correction, for training in righteousness. So we believe that all Scripture is inspired. Now, not everybody's interpretation of Scripture is inspired, but all Scripture is inspired. Amen? And so the Bible says in Timothy, to study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So what that verse tells you is that you have to study Scripture and meditate on it, let God speak to you. I reject the idea, and this happened, you know, for about 1,000 years in the church. They took the Scriptures out of the language of the common person. And so their church services were in Latin, the Scripture was in Latin, and so people couldn't understand. Isn't that sad? They couldn't understand. Because they didn't want people to know what the Scripture said, because they didn't want people to contradict what they were saying. And so talk about, it's like if you didn't know what the Constitution said, you didn't know what the Bill of Rights said, you wouldn't know your rights, you wouldn't know what this government, our nation is founded upon. And they could, if you depended on the leaders, they could tell you almost anything. And you say, well, I guess that's right. I mean, I don't know, they're telling me it. And that was the way it was with Scripture, is that the leaders basically were telling people, and they started to incorporate traditions and doctrines of men into the Scriptures. In fact, a lot of churches, and I'm not attacking churches, but I'm just attacking this idea that some churches, they believe that the Scripture's inspired, but also the leadership is inspired, and also tradition is inspired. And so they say that those three things are equal. And so if the leader of their church decides that he's going to incorporate something that's not scriptural, they say it's true because the leader said it's true. Or because it's a tradition handed down from the fathers, then it's true because tradition says it's true. But what we say is what Martin Luther said, sola scriptura, which means only by the Scriptures. In other words, everybody has to bow the knee to the Scriptures. Scripture is final authority. And if somebody tries to introduce something that is not scriptural, we reject it because Scripture is final authority. How many can see what I'm saying? And that's why, I mean, you know, people have different ideas. They introduce different things. And I'm not here. I don't like to criticize other churches. I don't feel like that's my job. I don't think my job is to judge other people, judge other preachers, judge other churches. That's not my job. But I just make a blanket statement that if it's not in the Scripture, I'm not interested. Does that make sense? And if it's not in the Scripture, I think you're on shaky ground by accepting it. So that's why we, like Martin Luther, who started the Reformation, we say sola scriptura, only by the Scripture. And so that's what we were talking about the last two times I was here. And today I want to talk about God is good. You should say all the time. All the time. God is good. That's one of the most common statements about God in the Bible, that he is good. Let me just give you a couple verses on that. Psalms 136, verse 1 says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever." Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Isn't that good? He is good. Psalms 145 verse 9 says, the Lord is good to all. The Lord is good to all, and his mercies over all his works. Another one, Psalms 118 verse 1 says, oh, give thanks to the Lord for what? He is good, and his mercy endures forever. How many can get the point here that there's something that the Bible is trying to tell you about God? That he is good. In fact, if you took every verse in the Bible where it says God is good or the Lord is good, we'd be here a long time. Because that is a common statement about God. And when I say God is good, I don't mean that he's good in some deep, mysterious, theological sense. Because, I mean, I used to have this simple doctrine. I said, God is good, the devil is bad. It was pretty simple. And then I had somebody say to me one time, yeah, but what's good to us and what's good to God are two different things. I said, wrong answer. I mean, the Bible is written so we'd understand it. And if the Bible says God is good, he's writing to us. He wants us to realize that God is good. Now, how many know that life can be hard? I mean, life can be filled with challenges. Life can be filled with hardships. Life can be filled with difficulties. But that doesn't change the fact that God is good. When Jesus was on the earth, I said this one week when I was preaching on this. I want you to go to Hebrews chapter 1 for a second. In verses 1 through 3, it says, God who at various times and in various ways spoke in times past to the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the worlds. The Son, now he's talking about the Son. The Son is the brightness of God's glory. The Son is the brightness of God's glory. The Son is the express image of his person. The Son is the express image of the person of God. Upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. And so what I said to you a couple weeks ago, if you remember, and this is really a powerful point. When I said this, I felt the Holy Ghost on it. But what I said to you was that in the Old Testament, God didn't lay out all truth in the Old Testament. In fact, if you take the names of God in the Old Testament, Jehovah, and then there's another name that goes with it, but the first name is always Jehovah. That's the name for God in the Old Testament. Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah Sitkenu, Jehovah Rapha. It's Jehovah, and slowly through the Old Testament, God revealed who he was through his names. So he would say, I'm Jehovah, because they didn't know. They didn't know what God was like, because they didn't have the written scriptures, and they didn't have a clear revelation. It was passed down from generation to generation. And so God says, let me tell you what I'm like. I'm Jehovah this. Then he would say, I'm Jehovah your victory. I'm Jehovah your healer. I'm Jehovah your peace. I'm Jehovah your righteousness. I'm Jehovah this. And every one of those redemptive names, they came over hundreds of years, but every one of them was a picture. God was showing you what he was like, what his nature was like. And so people started getting a revelation of what God was like. But just like you put together a puzzle, I don't know if you guys do puzzles, but you put together a puzzle, and every piece is a part of the puzzle. In this respect, every word was inspired. It's not that it was inspired. It says God spoke in times past to the prophets. But it was just one piece. There'd be a piece. There'd be another piece. There'd be another piece. Every piece was inspired. But what happened when Jesus came is that God stepped out of eternity and he became a man like us, and he showed us what God was like. In other words, it was like the cup, what's that, the picture on the box. When Jesus appeared, it's like the picture on the box. Oh, I get it now. And so he goes on to say that we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things that we have heard. Here's what the Greek says about this. God spoke at different times and in different parts. That is, he reveals one piece, then another piece, like pieces of a puzzle, with one piece complementing the other piece, until finally the puzzle takes shape and is finished. And so Jesus is basically the the full manifestation of God in a human form. It says in John chapter 14, I think I read this verse last time too, John chapter 14, verses 8 and 9, Philip asked Jesus, Lord, show us the Father. In other words, what is God like? What is the Father like? Show us the Father, and that will be all we need. And so, you know, people want to know what God is like. And so what did Jesus say? Jesus replied, Philip, I've been with you all this time, and you still don't know me or don't know who I am. How could you ask me to show you the Father? For anyone who has looked at me has seen the Father. And if you listen to Jesus' terminology or how he spoke, he said, I don't do anything unless the Father does it. I don't say anything unless the Father is saying it. In other words, like he says in Hebrews, I am a full expression of the Father. I am the full expression of God. In other words, if you want to know what God is like, just look at me. And so that's why when I look at Jesus, there's a lot of conclusions that I come to that religion doesn't come to. In other words, I don't see Jesus going around making people sick. Thank you for your enthusiasm. I don't see Jesus going around torturing people or tormenting people or afflicting people or hurting people. I see him rebuking the religious Pharisees. I see him setting things straight. But I see a different Jesus than a lot of times is projected in the church today. I know it's a simplistic approach I take, but I get it from looking at Jesus. You see, it's interesting. The book of Hebrews is characterized by the word better. Poke your neighbor and say better. Better. The book of Hebrews is characterized by the word better. Better. The book of Hebrews is characterized by the word better. And if you go through the book of Hebrews, what it says, and here's a few things I wrote down. The word better appears 12 times in the book of Hebrews. And every time it appears, there's something it's telling you is better. In other words, number one, Jesus is a better high priest. Now, some of us don't understand what high priests are, but the high priest was the one that took what the people sacrificed and he presented it to God. And it says that Jesus is a better high priest. Jesus is a better sacrifice. How many know that's true? In the Old Testament, it was bulls and goats. It was the sacrifice of animals. In the New Testament, it is the blood of Jesus Christ. How much better of a sacrifice is that? In fact, they had to sacrifice every year on a regular basis. The Bible says that when Jesus poured out his blood on the cross, that was the last and final sacrifice for all time. You know, they talk about, well, they're going to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem, and then they're going to start animal sacrifices. Are you kidding me? Think about what you're saying. They're going to start animal sacrifices? What about Jesus' sacrifice? Are you trying to tell me his sacrifice doesn't count anymore? Come on, people, wake up. His is a better sacrifice. It is a better covenant. You know, one thing that people don't understand, they look at the Old Testament, they scratch their head, they say, it just seems like God is an angry, distant God. But God blesses us and deals with us on the basis of covenant. And so in the Old Testament, they had a covenant, and it was ratified by the blood of animals. And God, through that covenant, worked with the people to bless them and bring them into his presence and to bring them into the land and to bring them into the blessings that he had for their life. But now we have a better covenant. Remember at the communion meal, Jesus sat down and he said, this is the new covenant. And it wasn't a surprise to them because it was talked about in the Old Testament that the day would come that God would establish a new covenant. And so Jesus established that new covenant. He said, this is the new covenant in my blood. I'm establishing this new covenant. And it's based on, so it's a better covenant, and it's based on better promises. That's another thing it says in Hebrews, better promises. It says that we have a better hope. We have a better priesthood. We have a better country, that is a heavenly one. We have a better word or a better message. You know what the gospel is? Guess what the gospel is? Good news. Why is it good news? It comes from a good God. You'd expect good news from somebody that's good. Wouldn't you? You'd expect some good news from somebody that's good. God is a good God. So he gives us the good news. You know, I heard a preacher say one time, he said the gospel is a word that means almost too good to be true news. It's almost too good to be true. Come on. It's like somebody tells you something, you go, that sounds too good to be true. That's what the gospel is. It's almost too good to be true. And that's what the gospel is. Well, it comes from a good God. We have a better, so here's some more things, a better standing with God. We are righteous because of the blood of Jesus. There's a better work of redemption, covers every aspect of our life. And there's a better resurrection. Those are all the betters. The better, not bitter, better. All the betters in the book of Hebrews. And so what he's doing in throughout the whole book of Hebrews, he's comparing the Old Testament, what God did with those people, and what God now has provided under the New Testament. And he's saying the New Testament is so much better, so much better. And so it's important for us to not just settle for just mediocre living. You know, like I said, life is full of challenges. Life is full of difficulties. You know, in the book of James, in fact, I'm going to jump ahead a little bit. Look at the book of James for just a second. James chapter 1. If you read the first few verses, James talks about, he tells you who he's writing to. He's writing to people that are surrounded by difficulties. You know, he says, my brethren, when you fall into difficulties and it's all around you, he goes, rejoice, which is kind of a weird response, right? We normally would complain or why me or self-pity or whatever. You know, I don't know what we would do. You know what you do, right? I mean, you know, I don't always know what you do, but you know what you do when you fall into trouble all around. But he says to rejoice. But then as you keep reading there, he gets down to verse 16. Now listen to this. He says, do not be deceived. Verse 16, do not be deceived. So what is he telling you? That you could be deceived. He said, do not be deceived. What are you talking about, James? My beloved brethren and sistren. That's brethren is a generic word that means everybody. Do not be deceived, my beloved brethren. Every good gift. Because see, they're going through difficulty. They might start thinking that God brought this. Or that God put this on them, or God did this to them. And so he says, don't get this wrong. Don't be deceived about this. Every good gift, every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. He doesn't change. He was good once. He's still good today. Aren't you glad about that? He's still good today. Praise God. I might get excited here yet. You know, here's another verse. Look at Acts chapter 10. Because, you know, I had this discussion one time with somebody, and they said that to me. They said, yeah, well, because I've said this many times when I preach. Of course, I used to say it a lot more, that God's a good God. God's good, and your faith needs to hear that. Your faith needs to have expectation that something good is going to happen. There's an Old Testament verse that says, I would have fainted lest I had believed to see the goodness of God in the land of the living. I would have fainted unless I believed to see the goodness of God. Where? In heaven? No, the land of the living, right here. God wants us to believe so that we'll see his goodness in manifestation. And so this guy said to me one time, he goes, yeah, well, here, you know, he thought I was shallow, which maybe I am shallow. I don't know. I could be shallow, but I've studied the Bible for almost 50 years, so I'm not too shallow. But I don't just mean I read a verse a day to keep the devil away. I mean, I studied it. And so he goes, he thought maybe I was shallow and that I didn't know the deeper things. And he said, well, you see, what's good to us and what's good to God is two different things. I said, is that right? That's right. And so sometimes God does these horrible things that we think are horrible, evil, terrible, killing kids, you know, stuff like that. God does all that. But he has some divine plan in it. I said, is that right? But here's a verse I like. I like verses like this. Now, I can't take time to point out all these verses, but look at Acts 10, verse 38. Acts 10, verse 38, it said, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power. So the Holy Ghost was, the Trinity is mentioned there, God, Jesus, and the Holy Ghost. So they're all complicit in this. They're all working together in this. The Trinity's working together in this. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, who went about doing what?
Good.
Doing what?
Good.
He went about doing good. So evidently God's got a definition of good, and he put it right in the Bible. He went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. There's a gnat in here somewhere. Healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. It says here that everyone that Jesus healed, and if you read through the Gospels, you should read through the Gospels sometime and just take note. There are like, let's see, there's like 21 different incidents of healing, a story of healing. But then there are just places where it said he just healed everybody. I mean, he healed everybody until nightfall, and then he went home. I mean, he just healed everybody. They brought everybody. They came from everywhere, and he healed everybody, it says. And so it says when he was doing that, he wasn't doing bad. Amen. When he was doing that, he was doing what?
Good.
Why? Because he is a good God. Bing. The light just popped on, right? He's a good God, and he describes healing as good. See, he doesn't want you to be oppressed. He doesn't want you to be depressed. He doesn't want you to be anxious. He said, be anxious for nothing. Just give it to me. You know, it's interesting. The Bible says we're supposed to cast all of our care over on him. I don't know if you've ever been in, but I've been in like legal situations. One time I got sued for millions of dollars. And it was a tough situation. It was nerve-wracking because I don't have millions of dollars. And so, I mean, it was a nerve-wracking situation. But all of a sudden you get a lawyer involved. And the lawyer goes, don't worry about it, I got this. You go, what? They don't have a leg to stand on. Don't worry about it, I got this. Say that one more time. Don't worry about it, I got this. You got this? I got this. Are you sure you got this? I got this. And I go, okay. And that's why he says, cast all your what?
Care
over on him. In other words, he goes, give that to me. And then what is he going to say?
I got this.
Go on with your life. I got this. And so he says, I got the care of this. I'll carry the care of this. You go free. You don't worry about it. You don't think about it. And if you do think about it, might get excited yet. I've been preaching a couple weeks. If you do think about it, just say, he's working on it. He's got it. He's not only he got you. I know that's not good English, but he got it, he got you. God's working on it. I mean, there's things that sometimes we have to do in the natural, but one thing we don't got to do is we don't got to worry about it. I refuse to worry about it. I refuse to have anxiety about it. I refuse to fret and get worked up over it because God's got this. Why? Because God is
good.
See, he said there, cast all your care upon him, for he cares for you. I like the Amplified. It says he cares about you affectionately and watches over you watchfully. You have never been loved until you've been loved by God. I mean, when I say that, you are loved by God, but I mean experience God's love. It's amazing. The love of God is amazing. Preach, Steve, I believe I will. So I believe this is a simple situation. Look at Psalms 27:13. I would have lost heart unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I would see the goodness. Remember what God is good. God, healing's good. How many know peace is good? How many know that joy is good? Oh, yeah. It's the fruit of the Spirit. In fact, it says that God, get this. It says that God laughs. See, I had a hard time with that picture because I always thought God's up and kind of got a big beard. Looks like Chuck Evers on steroids or something. You know what I mean? And he's, but Chuck's a lot more cheerful. But God was ticked. I mean, I was going to use the word pissed, but I didn't. I think that was wrong word to use in church. So I said he's ticked. And he's sitting there. He's got a cane that he hits people with. hits the angel flies by, sit down, stop flying around the room or something, you know. And so he's sitting there just, now what are they doing down there? Oh, they're all sinning. I knew it. Gonna send a little flood down there, a little judgment, a little plague, a little this, a little that, get things stirred up down there. That's what I'm gonna do. That's kind of how I saw God. You know, I mean, you're kind of walking around tiptoeing. Whoa, what are we doing? Are we okay? You know, all of a sudden, wham, you know, it's like God, you know, you're going along living your life and God sends angels down to, you know, kind of not kidnap you, but hijack you, or not hijack you, mug you. And so one angel's holding you, the other angels are working you over, you know. You know what I mean? I mean, that's kind of the image I had of God. Because, and the reason I did that was because I interpreted bad things that happened to me in life. I thought it all came from him. You know, it's interesting, the story of Job in the Bible. Job is the oldest book in the Bible, and people just talk about all that Job went through. And he did go through a lot, and he didn't deserve it, really. I mean, it did say one place that he said, the thing I feared, that fear opened the door. You could make an argument for that, but the bottom line is that Job was a good man and all this stuff. But what's interesting about it is, if you read the book, it kind of goes, here's what's happening on earth, and here's what's happening in heaven. And so what happens is you got this guy, Job. He's a good guy. And then the scene changes to heaven, and the devil's up there, and God goes, hey, did you check out Job? He don't even like you, devil. He's my man. He goes, hey, he's your man because you bless him. If you stop blessing him. And then God, I don't understand this, but then God said, behold, he's in your hand, but don't take his life. And then it says the devil went out from the presence of the Lord, and the devil smote Job. It doesn't say God smote him. It said the devil smote him. You say, well, God gave him permission. I don't know why that was, but it said the devil smote him. The devil did all those things to him. The devil, I mean, the whole thing came crashing down. It was the devil. I mean, it's very clear in the scriptures. But you know what James tells us in James chapter 5? It doesn't say, remember the beginning of Job. It says, remember the end of Job. That's what it tells us to remember. But everybody remembers the beginning. In fact, most people, I say, you know what end up happening to them? That most people go, no, I don't know. Think he'd probably just died. No. God gave him twice. He had, I don't know why anybody wants 7,000, 14,000 donkeys or whatever it was. I mean, you want to open your window and say, shut up! You know? Oh, you know? I mean, I've been to farms and it's like the whole time you're trying to talk, the stupid donkeys howling the whole time. You want to say, just want to yell and say, shut up. Can you imagine 7,000 of them going, shut up? Right? It's kind of like, you know, I don't know if you ever thought about this or not. This is how my mind works, okay? So God says, I'm bringing you to a land flowing with milk and honey. How many does that sound good? The only problem with milk and honey is milk comes from cows. Is that true? And cows leave manure. And honey comes from, and bee, of course, I know I said this one time, bees sting. And they said, no, bees, it's wasps that sting. But I don't know, but I've been stung by a bee. So bees sting. So you got all these, woo, milk and honey, but you got mooner and you got bees that sting. There's always a problem with the blessing. That's what I'm trying to say. And so what happened was God gave Job twice as much. God gave him twice as much. He got his kids back. He got his ladies back. And it says that he gave even gave his daughters an inheritance. And his daughters were the hottest chicks in the land, it says. I don't know why I brought that up, but they were hot. That's what it says. I'm just telling you. It's a little paraphrased version, but that's what it says. But why is that? Because why? God's good. But I think even the story of Job tells you that contrast between God's a good God and Satan's a bad devil. Amen? He's a bad devil. And Jesus delivered people from the forces of the enemy. Well, I goofed up my sermon here. Totally ruined it. And so the new covenant is based on all these new things. And what happens is we get to see God as he really wanted to be all along. Because let me read it again out of Hebrews chapter 1. That Jesus is the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person. His glory means God's glory. The brightness of God's glory. You know what the glory of God is? The glory of God is the very essence of God. It is the very nature of God. It is the very works of God, the power of God, the presence of God. That's the glory of God. And it says that Jesus is the brightness of God's glory. In other words, God's glory was shining out when Jesus was on the earth. Isn't that powerful? And now he went to heaven, but he sent the Holy Spirit so we could shine forth too. We could shine as lights in the world. We can do his works, the works of Christ, because he wants us to show humanity that he's still a good God. He still loves people. He's such a good God. But that doesn't mean that you won't go through things. Amen? Hallelujah. Well, I got one more thing I was going to tell you, but I wonder if I should tell you that or not. Should I tell you?
Yeah.
Okay, I got to make sure we get to the golf event soon enough because the rain's coming at 4 and we got to make sure we get done by then. I know a lot of you are sitting there thinking, oh, you got to be kidding me. You brought up golf at a time like this. But anyways, I want you to go to one last passage of Scripture. Turn to Exodus 33 and I'll close with this. Exodus 33. Did you guys get anything out of this? Thank you. Exodus 33, listen to this. And he, Moses, said, please show me your glory. He's talking to God. Please show me your glory. That was his prayer. God, show me your glory. Let's all close our eyes for a minute. You just say that out loud. Lord,
show me your glory.
So what is he asking for? He's asking to see the glory of God. Now, had Moses ever seen it before? He had. He saw it in the burning bush. He saw it when the Red Sea split. He saw it when manna came down from heaven. He saw it, water came out of the rock. There's all kinds of times that Moses, he saw it when God brought Egypt to its knees through the different signs and wonders. He saw the glory of God. But he saw what he had to do, and he said, I need more of your glory. I need more of your acts. I need more of your works in my life. Show me your glory. Now, here's what's interesting. We would all agree that what Moses asked for was to see the glory of God. But look at what God said. Then he said, God said, I will make all my what? Goodness. He didn't ask for goodness. He asked for glory. He wanted to see God's glory. And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before you. And I will proclaim the name of the Lord before you. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. And he said, you cannot see my face, for no man can see my face and live. And the Lord said, here is a place by me. Now listen to this next phrase. There is a place by me. There is a place by me. And you shall stand on what? A rock. So it shall be while my glory passes by, or all my goodness passes by, that I'll put you in the cleft of the rock. I'll cover you with my hand while I pass by. Then I'll take my hand away, and you'll see my back, but my face you'll not see. So here's what's interesting about this. First of all, the glory of God. In other words, when God is shining forth, when you're seeing God for who he is, what you'll see is goodness. When you see, when God is shining forth, when you see a bunch of bad things happening, that's not the glory of God. Remember Lazarus? You know, Jesus told them, if you believe, you'll see the glory of God. He told Mary and Martha that. He said, if you can believe, you'll see the glory of God. What's the glory of God? What was it? It was Lazarus having been dead 4 days. Lazarus having been dead 4 days will come back to life again. He goes, that's the glory of God. In other words, God is shining forth. But how many know Mary and Martha, if you had asked them, what do you guys think of that? They'd say, that was good. wouldn't they? They wouldn't say, well, that's bad. That was a bad thing. No, they would say, that's good. And so he said, if you can believe, you'll see the glory of God. You'll see goodness. And so that's why the psalmist said, I would have fainted lest I believed to see the goodness of God. But here's the thing I want you to see here. He said, here is a place by me. Go back and read it again. Put it back up there. Here is a place by me, and you shall stand. Where is Jesus seated? Right hand of the Father. By him. What is one of the names of Jesus? It's the rock. Right? And so what God did is he put Moses on Christ. And standing on... Oh, man, this is going to be good. I might get excited. I don't know if you will. But there, Moses, standing in Christ, saw all God's goodness pass in front of him. Isn't that powerful? Because here's what God did when he put us in Christ. If you are a Christian, you are in Christ. That's what Ephesians chapter 2 says, that he seated us in heavenly places in Christ. We're in Christ. Over 100 times in the New Testament, Paul uses that phrase, in Christ. And we sing that song, in Christ alone. Because when we get saved, we're in Christ. He puts us in Christ. So in Christ, when we are in Christ, we are in a position to experience all God's goodness. You say, I don't know if I qualify. You qualify. Why? How do I qualify? You're in Christ. If you're in Christ, you qualify for all God's goodness. You know, it says in Ephesians chapter 1, I thought you'd be more excited about that one. When I read that and saw that, I had to stand up and go, whew, that's good. That's good. Because, you know, sometimes people don't know if they qualify. I don't know if I qualify. I don't know if I'm good enough. You know, I have made a lot of mistakes. Kind of a jerk to my wife sometimes. I'm not going to talk about all the times she's a jerk to me, but you know what I mean? Just going to tell my story. You know, sometimes I don't feed the cat on time. In fact, we went on a trip and I forgot to feed the cat. The cat's out there. What's going on here? And then I told somebody to feed him, and then they forgot. So I came back and the cat's like, what is going on in this place? This is a gulag or something? I mean, come on, let's step it up around here, you know. But what was I saying? So, you know, you feel kind of like a jerk sometimes. You go, do I qualify? If you're in Christ, you qualify. You qualify for all God's goodness. Let's all stand up together. So, what's the glory of God? Everybody say goodness. God's good. Because God's goodness, because God is good. And the gospel is what? Good news, because good news comes from a good God who cares about us. Amen? Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Let's all bow our heads for a moment. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. God, reveal yourself to us. God, show us your goodness. God, show us your glory. God, let us experience another dimension. You said in your word that we go from glory to glory. Let us experience another dimension of your glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for what you have done. But Lord, we just pray for another dimension of your glory. Lord, let your glory pass by one more time. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Show us your glory. Pass by our lives. Hallelujah. In a sense, Lord, in Revelation, showing us again another dimension of the glory of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let every person in this place, I pray their eyes would be anointed with eye salve, that they could see who they are in Christ and your goodness over their lives. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Will you say one more time, Lord, show me your glory? Say it like a prayer. Say, Lord. Say it like you're drawing it out. Lord, show me your glory. Hallelujah. Get ready to see God's goodness. Hallelujah. Get ready to see God's goodness. Get ready to see God show himself to you, reveal something to you in a dream, in a vision, in his word, through his word, through someone else speaking into your life. God's going to show you his glory. Praise God. Let's sing this song.
You're never
God. Well, let's just lift our hands and say, thank you, Jesus, that you are good. Hallelujah. You are good, Lord. You're a good God. Cares about us. Hallelujah. You're a good God that cares about us. Praise God. You know, it's interesting. David said, I would have fainted because he was experiencing difficulty. And we do. We experience difficulty. Anybody that says you can have enough faith, you not experience difficulty, he's lying to you. Until Jesus comes back, or till you go to heaven, there's going to be difficulty in this life. But he went on to say, I believed. He goes, I would have fainted unless I believed to see the goodness of God. And your faith needs to see that God's good. Your faith needs to be in an environment where God's a good God, where you see that God's good. He's good. He's good to all. And you want to tap in, you want to believe for that goodness in your life. We're going to have the prayer counselors come up. They could come up now. And so if you need prayer for anything, we just give you the opportunity to be prayed for and have God's blessing. Have these people believe with you for the goodness of God to be upon your life. Amen. Well, life's good. Amen. It's great to have you here today. You're a great looking bunch of people. Just pray God's blessing on you this week, that you experience his favor over everything that you do. Amen. If you are playing golf, we're going to be leaving here pretty soon, within 15, 20 minutes to go eat and then head out there. So God bless you, everybody. You're free to go. God bless.